brother.
You're my hero.
Oh, that's a kind thing to say, brother. Yes, yeah. Nice to see you, sister. Good to see you. Yes, yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, once you've decided that the truth is more important than your job, then you're free from fear of loss. But when you're paralyzed by fear of losing your job, your career, your license, or your ordination, then you're not going to do what is right. And there are too many, we call these velvet handcuffs. Our jobs, our licenses, our ordinations, these are velvet handcuffs that stop people from being willing to speak the truth. Yeah. So I just came to the conclusion the truth is more important. So, yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes. So I'm going to the restroom before I go up. Okay. Hello, sisters. Cute. Oh, praise the Lord. I hear you're going to Africa, are you? No? You should go. Yeah, you'll be blessed. You'll be blessed. No. That, you know, you just blow through it. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Thank you, sister. Hello, sister. Oh. Oh, we're waiting. I've got about 5 hours. A chance it's 4 hours. I've got to put 4 this morning. No, right, you go first. All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, sorry. If we can just recognize that we are still in God's house, that would be such a beautiful thing to do. We are in the sanctuary of God where God resides. Our tone, our talking needs to be at a very hushed moment. If we want to talk and talk, let's bring our conversation outside God's house. But we are all here to worship God in spirit and in truth. He is an almighty, holy God. So remember where we are. We are in His presence, and we don't want His presence to leave us. Amen? Amen. Amen.
I'd rather just use a bucket or a drop hole. Huh?
We're going to sing a couple songs as before we move on. It's been raining here for, I don't know, a few hours, and we've had a lot of rain. But I tell you what, whether it's rain or whatever, it's a blessing. If you turn to 195, we're going to sing Showers of Blessings. Showers of Blessings. How many's been blessed? If you came y'all last night and today, you've been blessed.
But it wasn't Mary.
As I was talking to the lady next to me, we're blessed to live here. And not traveling them rivers and snakes and all that kind of thing. Anyway.
So I just saw your wife go.
195, Showers of Blessings. There shall be showers of blessings. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessings, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessings. precious reviving again. Over the hills and the valleys, sound of abundance of rain, showers of blessings, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops from the surface, but for the showers we plead, there shall be showers of blessing. Send them upon us, O Lord. Grant us to now a refreshing. Come now and honor thy word. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessings we plead. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead, there shall be showers of blessings. Oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing, now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessing, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead.
You know, the song says, when do we want his blessings? Now. Amen. We're praying for the Holy Spirit to descend now. We're praying to be blessed now, even today. I want to sing two verses of 184. Jesus paid it all. We'll sing the first and the last. First and the last. How many believe Jesus paid it all? Amen. Amen.
Sabbath. How many are here for Sabbath school? Wow, most everyone. Did you enjoy it? Put your hand in there if you enjoyed it. Amen. It's the Sabbath, and we are so thankful at Jasper that many other churches are joining us today. I had the privilege of working with Conrad Vine for a little bit more than 10 years, and there's two things that I could say about him, and that is that he invests in people. He made a director out of me when I know that I'm not director material, but he kept investing in me. He asked me if I'd be a field director with Diane, and we went out for 8 years and did field directing. And he said we did a good job, but I don't know, you know. When you're out there, it seems like a total different thing. Feel like you're a failure. And but during that time, we started Adventist Frontier Missions in Korea, and he mentioned European Adventist Frontier Missions. During his time, he brought on all the other ones, South America, South Africa, Brazil. I know I'm forgetting some. Europe, well, anyway, he has learned how to somehow stay awake. I know he has very little time to sleep because he works so much. We would call him in the middle of the night, and he would be there for us. He would say, I'm in bed. Let me get away from Luda, and then I'll take your call. You'd hear him go into the other room. And we always appreciated that Conrad Vine was willing to do that kind of thing. We have an announcement. Ken, would you come up and do an announcement? And we're going to streamline the program. As Ken comes up, I'm just going to tell you we've had enough mission spotlight today, and Conrad's going to do more. We're going to cut out that. And Madeline is going to save her health nugget for another Sabbath. So go ahead.
Just want to say happy Sabbath, Saints. I just want to remind those of you that are wondering whether or not we're going to have the End of Time series at 4 o'clock like we generally do in the evening. We're using the book by Vance Farrell, and we've been having very good turnout, and we invite you to come and be a part of it. That's every evening at 4 o'clock, but this Sabbath we're going to forego that till the following week. And also, I would like to meet briefly with Brother Hall, Arnold Hooker, Madeline Ortiz, Larry Nicholas, Leonard Bland, and Judy Sherrill. Just like to meet briefly with you as we put together our strategy as we're getting ready to go out into the South Pittsburgh area. Our attention is to establish a church in that area. And we're gonna have a Revelation Seminary, seminar in that area. And the principal of the school there in South Pittsburgh was gracious enough to allow us to have an auxiliary room, which is an auditorium, for the month of July. So we're gonna be doing a Revelation Seminar. You know, so please keep that in mind. We invite you to come and be a part of it. And also, we're going to be going out in the field with the Amazing Fact Bible Study lessons next week. So we're asking for the members of the church and anyone else that would like to join with us as we go out and we begin to recruit people in Bible studies, getting them ready for the Revelation Seminar. God bless you.
The rest of the announcements, I'm only going to mention the nominating committee is now meeting, and we just want you to say yes. That's it. Yes, we'll do it. And we're thankful again that we can be gathered in God's house today. We are privileged as Seventh-day Adventists to still be able to worship freely. Amen? We know time is coming when it may not be so easy to worship. And so I'm very thankful that we are here together today. If it feels a little warm, I don't know. You saw the pictures in Papua New Guinea. They just take their shoes off. And in Thailand, they do the same thing. Now, if you don't have the odor eaters in, please don't do it. But it may be a good thing to cool off somehow. I don't know. But I'm going to continue the worship service and start the worship service with, we're skipping right down to Psalms 62, 1 to 4. Psalms 62, 1 to 4. I'm sorry? Oh, we can stand for this. Good idea. Psalms 63. I'm glad you guys said that because I would have read 62 for sure. Psalms 63, 1 to 4. O God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. So I have looked for you in the sanctuary. I see your power and your glory, because your loving kindness is better than life. My lips shall praise you. Thus I will bless you while I live, while I will lift up my hands in your name. Amen. Continue standing while we have the invocation.
Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Heavenly Father, we thank you that the Sabbath day is here. We thank you that we can step aside from our work, a week for many of worry. And as we step into your presence, Father, I ask that you will bring peace to our hearts. Father, still the voices of this world, the lies that swirl around our heads day after day. And today, Father, we would hear truth, the truth of your character and the truth of your purpose for each one of us and for our dying world. So, Father, I pray that truth will be triumphant during this worship hour. And I pray that your Holy Spirit will bring conviction to each of our hearts and minds as to how, where, and when we are to play our part in earth's final days. Father, protect this house of prayer with your angels. Do not allow men of violence to come in here. I pray, Father, that you'll drive away any spirit not of your kingdom, that you'll bring those spirits into judgment today. And I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will be the only spirit present in these four walls. So, Father, speak to our hearts and our minds. Lord, I pray that we will leave this place different men and women to those who entered the doors this morning. May our worship, may our praise, may our prayers, may our preaching, may all that is said and done bring honor and glory to you. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. It's time for a hymn of prayer. Bill, you want to make your way up here and do the hymn of prayer? Hymn of praise. I cannot sing, so I'm going to have to. Oh, thank you, Seth. Thank you for making your way up.
Hymn of praise. I was looking for some extra seats because we do have more people coming, so if I come around and pick a seat next to you.
Page 610.
610. Stand.
O Christian, awake, 'tis the Master's command, with helmet and shield and a sword in thy hand, to meet the bold tempter. Go, fearlessly go, and stand like the brave, with thy face to the foe. Stand like the brave, stand like the brave, stand like the brave, with thy face to the foe. The cause of thy Master with eager defend, be watchful, be zealous, and fight to the end. Wherever he leads thee, go valiantly, go. Then stand like the brave, with thy face to the foe. Brave, stand like the brave, stand like the brave, with thy face to the foe. son, never doubting, thy captain is near with grace to supply and with comfort to cheer. His love like a stream in the deserts will flow, then stand like a brave with your face to the
be seated. It's time for the Lamb's offering, and this is something we can't cut out of this church. We cut a little bit of this and that out today, but the Lamb's offering is the time when the children come and take their baskets around, and the money that you put into these baskets goes for the little church across the street. I mean the little school across the street. And we're excited. We see young people that come to that church change, I mean to that set, that school changed. And so I mean, we know you have some dollars, and some of you have some $5 and $10 and $20, and I saw a $50. But don't be afraid to support our school.
Good morning. How many of you like to go camping? Okay. I figured with all of the adventurers and pathfinders and scouts we have in the church, there'd be a more. Let me ask everybody out here, how many like to go camping? Okay. Of course. How many would like to see a bear? Nobody? How about out here? Okay, there's some out here that want to see a bear. Okay, how many would like to see a bear while they're camping? Okay, okay, yeah, we got some hands, brave. They're getting braver. Okay, a few less hands. Okay, depends on the type of bear, okay. So I thought, when I grew up, we had my aunt and uncle and cousins lived in Los Angeles, and we lived up by Portland, Oregon. And so for the summer, usually we would get together and meet someplace like Yellowstone or Grand Canyon or someplace like that and, you know, spend some time together. So this summer we decided we were going to meet at Yellowstone. I thought that was very appropriate because the Pathfinders are going to Gillette, Wyoming this summer for their big camporee. And so I thought, this might just hit the nail on the head. So anyway, so we had a great time in Yellowstone. We got to see lots of animals, and we got to see the geysers shooting off, and we got to see the mud pots going boop, 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 boop. And we just got to see so much neat things, and we had such a great time with everybody together. And so during the trip, we had shared, you know, of course, the food and the plates and the dishes and the spoons and stuff. And so the last evening, just before we were going to separate and they were going to head back down to LA and we were heading back to Portland, after it got dark and we were done with supper, we were going to separate all of the silverware and plates and stuff. So my cousins and my brother and I, we kind of made a game out of it. So we were kind of arguing over the silverware at the picnic table. And so we were like, oh, no, that's ours. No, no, that's yours. No, here, this is ours. And we were just kind of fooling around. And I had an older cousin that I thought she was pretty, pretty cool. You know, I maybe even had a little crush on her. But anyway, we had taken our little dog, and we had the dog's dish full of food just a little ways off of the picnic table. And it got, you know, it was dark, and we were arguing, and I would sneak away from the table, and I would sneak around up behind my cousin, and I'd put my hands up on her back and go, "Arr!" and drag my fingers down her back. And she would, "Oh!" And of course, everybody thought it was a bear. And so I'd go back, and we'd sit, and we'd start arguing, over the silverware, and then I would slip out. I'd slip up behind her again, and she probably knew it was coming. But anyway, she was playing along, so I'd sneak up behind her, and I'd go, "Arr!" She'd jump and scream. And so anyway, got back down. We were arguing. So about the third time I got up, and I slipped around, and I was coming up behind her, and I just out of the corner of my eye, I looked to the left, and there at the dog's dish, there was a bear. And he was just within arm's length. And I was so scared, I couldn't say a thing. And I just turned around, and Dad said later, it looked like I was high-stepping. I was like that. And my aunt and uncle, they had an old Volkswagen bus. You guys haven't seen them, but a lot of people out here will know what I'm talking about. And it was the kind that had all the little windows up on top. It had glass all over the place. I ran over there. That was the first vehicle I came to. I yanked open the door, jumped in, locked it, rolled up the window. And I'm like, and I was like, oh man, maybe I should say something. Okay, I'll say something. So I rolled down the window. I said, "Hey, you guys, there's a bear over there." What do you think they said? They said, "Nah, there's no bear." So they kept arguing about the silverware and stuff. And I said, "Hey, you guys, there really is a bear over there." And they were like, "Are you kidding? After what you've been doing? No, can't be." And so anyway, about the third time again, I said, "There really is a bear." And all of a sudden, everybody, just like a flock of chickens, just poof, away from the table. Well, my one cousin had had polio when he was young, and he couldn't walk. He couldn't use his feet. And he had put his crutches under the table. So he was left there, and my dad stayed there. My dad was always the cool, calm, collected type, had everything kind of under control, and he stayed there. And my cousin was frantically trying to find his crutches, and by then the bear had gotten finished eating the food, and he started walking around the table. And my dad was down where all of the dishes were, where the dish pan was full of water. And so he just grabbed the dish pan full of water and threw it on the bear. And the bear rose up on his back legs, and he looked around, and then he dropped down, and then he left. So thankfully, you know, to my cousin, who was frantically trying to find his crutches, the bear left. But and I brought something. It's not going to bite you, but you can pet it if you're brave enough. Okay, and there's American black bears. There's a lot of variety in color. They're probably the most variety of any big mammal. There's brown ones, there's black ones, and there's totally white ones. There's not very many of them, but they're all black bears, and the name sounds kind of weird, you know, when you call this one even a black bear. You want to pet it? Okay. You just want to touch his nose? Pet him on the back. It's a little softer. Yeah. And you see his claws? Got some pretty good sized claws. You want to touch him? You want to pet him? Okay. There you go.
Bob Abram has a museum at his house. He does private showings. All you have to do is get a hold of him. He's got more of that kind of thing at his house. And it's quite interesting. If you have a chance to go by Bob Abram's house, don't everyone do it today, but get an appointment, and he'd love to show you that those things that he has. It's time for our time for giving and to the church. You want to mark your tithe envelopes properly. Today it's for the evangelism for the conference, and we want those tithe envelopes marked properly. So if you pull the tithe envelope, the loose offering is going to go to church budget. And then at the end of Conrad Vine's time here today after church, we're going to do a love offering. He drove here and he stayed at my house and ate with me. He didn't charge us anything for coming. And so we want to love him back to Michigan. And so as the deacons come forward, keep that in your mind. Father in heaven, I thank you so much that you have already given us everything that we need. And there's no one here that hasn't been blessed by you, and that you have given us everything. All of our money is yours. You gave it to us from the start. We ask, Lord, that you would bless the offering as it's collected. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's time for the church where we have garden prayer, and because of the full church today, we usually have people come forward, but if we all came forward, it would be really full up here. So I'm just gonna ask, as those who are able to kneel right where you're at, and we'll have prayer. Kind Heavenly Father, we thank you each one for bringing us here safely. We thank you for taking care of all of our needs. We thank you that we've come from different places and we're all Seventh Adventists, and we ask, Lord, that you would bless each person that came today. And if there's someone here that is not a part of this church, we pray, Lord, that they would realize that you're coming very soon. And whether or not they're a Seventh Adventist or not, I ask, Lord, that you would come into each of our hearts. Come into this sanctuary today. Bring the angels here. Help us to hear them. Help us to reverence your sanctuary. We thank you, Father, for hearing and answering our prayers. We ask, Lord, that you would be with Conrad as he speaks with us. And Lord, if it's a message we need to hear, I pray that we would allow it to penetrate us. And Lord, I thank you again for the Sabbath. We look forward to eternity, saying glory, glory, glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's time for worship and music, special music, and sit back and enjoy.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Lord, it's a full house today. Praise the Lord. Sister Thomas and I are going to minister to you in music this morning, but before we do, I want to read a couple of passages. One from Testimonies to the Church. It's on. one from Testimonies to the Church, and another from the Gospel of Mark. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 4. It says, "It would be well to spend a thoughtful hour each day reviewing the life of Christ from the manger to Calvary. We should take it point by point and let the imagination vividly grasp each scene, especially the closing ones of his earthly life. By thus contemplating his teachings and sufferings and the infinite sacrifice made by him for the redemption of the race, we might strengthen our faith, quicken our love, and become more deeply imbued with the Spirit which sustained the Savior." Mark chapter 10, verses 32 to 34. "And they were in their way going to Jerusalem, and Jesus went before them, and they were amazed, and they followed. They were afraid. And they took again the 12 and began to tell them what things would happen to him. And he took again the 12 and began to tell them what would happen to them, saying," this is what he said, "Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be delivered unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death and shall deliver him to the Gentiles, and they shall mock him and shall scourge him and shall spit upon him and shall kill him." Here's the beautiful thing. "And the third day he shall rise again."
Then came the morning. light was turned to day. The stone was rolled away. Hope rose with the dawn. Then came the morning. Shadows vanished before the sun. Death had lost and life had won, for morning had come. Here comes the morning, night has turned to day, the clouds have vanished before the sun. Death had lost and life had won, for morning had come. The clouds have rolled away. Eternal dawn. Shadows vanished before the sun. Death had lost and life had won, for morning had
Oh, I didn't expect that. That's very moving. Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, Sam. The scripture reading today before Conrad Vine comes up to speak to us is found in John chapter 9 and verses 1 to 4. Now Jesus passed by. As Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And his disciples asked, saying, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man's or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work." Conrad Vine, I told you there was two things that I knew about him. The second thing is that he never does anything without worship and prayer. At Adventist Frontier Missions, every day at noon, the whole group stops at noon for a half hour to pray. Before he has any meetings with his colleagues, we pray. Before a board of directors meetings, they pray. They have a worship. This man has brought worship to Adventist Frontier Missions like never was before. Welcome, Conrad Vine.
Thank you very much, Arnold, for those gracious words. It's, let me just set this thing up here, make sure I'm showing. All right, shall I try doing the full slideshow? Yeah? All right, there we are. Okay? It's showing. So, praise the Lord. I want to echo my appreciation to Brother Sam and Sister Barbara. That was beautiful music. It appealed to our eyes, it appeared to our ears, it appealed to our hearts. And so thank you so much for that. And I will say thank you to Brother Bob for your children's story. That bear was a memorable thing. I go often to northern Saskatchewan, and we were there once. There was a man in our group who had constipation. And he went out to the privy, which is like 50 yards away in the bushes. And there's a lot of brown and black bear up there and wolf. And he went out there in the middle of the night because he was struggling. Well, we heard screams. And we flashed our flashlights out, and there was a brown bear gnawing at the brass hand knob on the door. So we fired a few shotgun rounds in the air, and the bear ambled off into the woods, and we came and we opened the door, and his constipation was gone. So, bears are a fruitful vein for children's stories. So it's my privilege to come and share with you here today. It really is a privilege to come and stand in the pulpit. You know, I'm mindful of James chapter 3, that those who presume to teach will be held to a higher standard by God. And in the New Testament, the verb to preach, keiruso, is normally used for pagans and unbelievers. And the verb used in the church is didasko, that is to teach. So when we have like whoever the preacher today is, it's implying that everybody in the congregation is a lost pagan. And really, we should be using the word teaching, the teaching for today, rather than the sermon for today. But anyway, the sermon today is called Work, for the Night is Coming. And all the texts are going to be up on the screen, the main texts. I'm struggling with my preaching these days because, as I said last night, I've got four pages here, which should be 45 minutes. So we're going to try and get done by 2 o'clock. And but as I'm going through, I sometimes jump into a text here and there as the Holy Spirit prompts. So keep your Bibles handy, because we will be looking into some texts. When I was in England, I used to think, why do people need PowerPoints for their sermons? Isn't this kind of ridiculous? Why can't people just have their Bibles in their hands? Then I realized, when I started as a pastor, that we have some people in the church whose fingers are arthritic, and they can't get to the pages quick enough. And we've got mothers with babies in their arms, and they can't get to the text quick enough. And we have people who've never held a Bible before, and you say, let's drop into Galatians and then Exodus. They don't know where those passages are, and they're too embarrassed to pick up a Bible and show they're trying to figure out where it is. And so I realized that in a very diverse community with people in different stages of life, it is better to show the text up on the screen. So I will show the text up on the screen, but there are occasions when I'll just drop into another text, and then I'll indicate, and you can pick up that verse for yourself in your own Bible. So let's bow our heads and invite the presence of the Holy Spirit among us. Our dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you today for the gift of life. We want to thank you for the promise of eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. And Father, as we reflect today on Jesus and him being the light of the world and us being the light of the world, I want to ask that the living Jesus will shine in each of our lives in this coming week. Father, may people take note that from this Sabbath on, we've spent time with the light of the world. Lord, may people know that no matter what our backgrounds, no matter what our education levels, no matter whether we drive a Ferrari or a Ford, that we have spent time with the man from Nazareth. So Lord, as I speak this morning, may my words be taken from your throne of grace. Father, whatever I say today, I pray that your Spirit will speak through me and for me, that you will bring conviction into every heart that is present here today in an area where you know where we all need to grow. And so, Lord, may our hearts be open and willing to be touched by the finger of God today. Lord, speak through me. Forgive me for my sins. Watch over those who are watching online. May your blessing rest upon them as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the sermon today is entitled Work, for the Night is Coming. And this is our journey today. We're going to start out with the shining light, and then we're going to move on to the gathering doom, and then we're going to look at the darkest gloom, and then we're going to come to our conclusions, okay? So that's our journey today, and you can follow me in your own mind. You can kind of mentally click off the bits as we go through it. When I was listening to my father preach as a young boy,
my father would say, this is a six-part sermon. I'd time the first part. And I'd mentally project forward to when lunch was going to begin, okay? So I understand that some people like to make those projections, but we have a three-part sermon today, the shining gloom, the shining light, the gathering doom, and the darkest gloom, and then we come to our conclusions. And I really appreciate the song that was sung today that mentioned Jesus then comes the morning, when morning overcomes darkness. And morning represents the resurrection as opposed to the darkness of the grave and the death of Christ. So we're going to start out first with the shining light. And we're going to start out where our scripture was in John chapter 9, verses 1 through 2. And it says there that as he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Now, the setting for this particular scene in the life of Jesus, if you go back to John chapter 7, this is in Jerusalem, and this is the Feast of Tabernacles, which you might say is a harvest festival for us today, and some Jews celebrate it as a festival of light. And Jesus is walking around the temple with his disciples, and they meet a man who's been blind from birth. And the disciples, reflecting their Jewish heritage and their Jewish culture, and every disciple reflects their national culture and national heritage, they ask a question of Jesus, and they say, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Well, we look back at them and think, oh, you foolish disciples. But the fact of the matter is, they had good reason to ask this question. The Talmud, now, they didn't have the Talmud in the first century AD, but they did have the traditions of the Jews. Do you remember Jesus condemned the traditions of the Jews in Mark 7? You set the teachings of men over the commandments of God. In Galatians chapter 1 and verse 14, Paul says that he was more advanced in Judaism than his contemporaries, being more zealous for the traditions of the Jews. That word traditions, those are the oral traditions that the Jews passed on from Moses all the way down through to the time of Christ. And there were two bodies of work. There was the Mishnah, which was the Jewish and the Aramaic and the Palestinian traditions. And there was the Gemara, that was the Babylonian traditions from the dispersion from the time of Nebuchadnezzar onwards. And in about the second and third century, they get combined to what we now call the Talmud. But the fact of the matter is, even though these things weren't written, those Jewish disciples knew what was written about sin. The Talmud says this, there is no death without sin, and there is no suffering without iniquity. So this is one of the traditions of the Jews. This is what they would have heard preached in the pulpits from Sabbath to Sabbath in their synagogue. It goes on to say, a sick man does not recover from his sickness until all his sins are forgiven him. So you start to see why when the man is lowered down through the roof in Mark 2, the first thing Jesus says to him is, son, he says, thy sins are forgiven thee. Remember that? We think as Westerners that his biggest need is his physical paralysis. But Jesus knows in that Jewish context that before the man can be physically healed in the eyes of the Pharisees, he must be spiritually forgiven. And so the Talmud says that a man does not recover from his sickness until his sins are forgiven him. And for the rabbis, God gives judgment that is appropriate to the sin that led to the judgment. Let me give you an example. According to the Mishnah, I'm quoting here, Samson went after the desire of his eyes. Is that true? Yes. Therefore, says the Mishnah, the Philistines put out his eyes. Absalom gloried in his hair. Is that true? Therefore, says the Mishnah, he was hanged by his hair. So some rabbis, they taught at the time of Christ that such a man as this, blind from birth, he was blind because of prenatal sins. In his mother's womb, he was guilty of sin, some kind of sin. Now, if the parents had sinned, maybe this was a fulfillment of Exodus 20, which says the Lord visits the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of those that hate him. And this idea today that you are guilty, that you suffer today because of sins or failures in a previous stage of life, it still happens in many parts of the world today. For instance, in Hinduism and Buddhism, where you have the idea of positive karma and negative karma, and if you come back as a good person in this life, it's because in the previous life you were a very good person, and if I'm bad in this life, my negative karma outweighs my positive karma, then in the next life I'll come back as a rat maybe, okay? And so there is a good reason why Hindus are vegetarian. You could be eating your mother, for instance, okay? Because you may have come back in a lower life form. So this idea is deeply ingrained in humanity that people suffer today because of some sin that was committed somewhere in the past. It's not just Judaism has this idea. Hinduism and Buddhism today has this idea as well. And so the Hindu wouldn't just ask who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind. They would ask another question, such as, did he sin in a previous life? Now, this idea of sinning in a previous life now permeates the West via the New Age movement. But the Bible rejects these concepts completely. According to the scripture, and this is a summary, every person present here today is uniquely made in the image of God. Each one of us is confronted with a call to believe in Christ on a personal level. Each one is responsible to our Heavenly Father for our lives. We must account for every word, every deed, and every thought, Hebrews 10:29. And Jesus' urgency in verse 4, which we're going to come to in a minute, shows how incompatible his teachings are with modern ideas. The time to work is now. The time to give your life to Jesus Christ is now, because we don't know whether we have a tomorrow at all. We don't have multiple lives where I can mess up in this life, I'll come back in another life, and I'll make things right with God. That idea is foreign to Scripture. It is a falsehood spoken by Satan in the Garden of Eden, that we are immortal. We'll come to that later on in our time together today. We have to deal with the questions of sin and salvation today, because we may not make it home today in our vehicles. Therefore, we need to make sure that we are right with God today. And I wouldn't be doing my job as a preacher if I weren't to say that. The day of salvation is today. And Jesus will in no wise cast any aside who come to him in faith. Part of the good news of the gospel. So how does Jesus respond? Because the disciples are asking a good question here. Jesus responds in verse 3 by saying this: neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. Now, when you first read this, it seems kind of harsh. It kind of implies that God allowed this man to be born blind and then to beg for about 38 years in order that one day after 38 years, Jesus could come along and heal him of his blindness. That's what the text kind of implies, at least in the English here. A better reading of the text would read as follows: neither hath this man sinned nor his parents, but as a result of his suffering, the works of God will be made manifest in him. So Jesus doesn't explore or explain the cause of this man's blindness in this particular passage, but he did tell the disciples and the Jewish leaders and us today what will be the result of this man's suffering. That is, this man's suffering leads to an opportunity for God to be glorified in his life. The disciples are focused on this man's suffering. Jesus is concerned about how God is going to be glorified in this situation. And so the text goes on: we must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. Now, early in John's gospel, in chapter 4, chapter 5, and chapter 6, Jesus says almost an identical thing. He says, I must work the works of him who sent me. That's what he says repeatedly through this gospel. Jesus had a sense that he was called, he was sent, he was commissioned by his Heavenly Father for a very particular purpose. And when you know that God has called you and equipped you and commissioned you and sent you for a purpose, then it's easier to get through life, is it not? Amen. And it seems to me that, you know, particularly men, women as well, but particularly men need mountains to climb because it gives them purpose. And men without purpose are kind of like spent bullets. They're just drifting aimlessly. They're not doing any good for anybody. But Jesus was very conscious that he had a job to do and he was going to be faithful in doing what his Heavenly Father asked him to do. Jesus was conscious of his Heavenly Father, of his Heavenly Father's will for him, and he was determined to fully follow the will of God, modeling for us what it means when we pray the Lord's Prayer. So when we pray the Lord's Prayer, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. When we pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, where in this planet do you have any control? If not in your own life. I have no control over Ukraine or of Gaza. I have no control of what happens in Tennessee or Michigan. But I do have control and sovereignty and authority in what happens in my own life, what I allow into my mind, in how I relate to my wife, in how I relate to our children, in how I do my taxes, because it's tax season right now. Am I going to be honest or not? So when we pray as Christians, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, we're saying to Lord, may your will be done in my life, because that's the only place where I have direct control over it. And when we pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, we're essentially praying the same prayer as Jesus in Gethsemane, which is not my will, but thy will be done. So this prayer, that thy will be done, when we pray the Lord's Prayer, which we should pray as Christians on a daily basis, because give us this day our daily bread, it's a daily prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Jesus is teaching us that we are to submit our will, to surrender our wills to the will of our Heavenly Father. And if I don't know the will of my Heavenly Father, I need to seek for His will. So Jesus modeled for us in this passage here that I must work the one of Him who sent me. He's teaching us that we are also to do the will of our Heavenly Father. We're to seek His will. We're to ask God for the discernment to perceive His will. We're to ask God for the grace to accept His will, because sometimes it's not something we enjoy. And we're to ask God for the courage to fulfill it and walk through with it. But the text is kind of ambiguous. It says, my version says, we must work the works of Him. Does it mean that I must work the works of Him from the perspective of Jesus, or does it mean that we must work the works of Him who sent Christ? Literally, it says this: it is necessary to work the works of the one having sent me while it is day, cometh night when no one is able to work. So Jesus is not merely speaking of Himself in this passage, but He's speaking of all His disciples, and in this context, He's speaking about your response to human suffering. He's speaking about a man who is blind, and this speech, I must work the will of my Father, the one who sent me. Jesus is about to heal this man. And so Jesus is speaking about our response to the reality of human suffering. You know, the existence of human suffering is not a call, an invitation to sit and ponder and reflect on the meaning of suffering. The existence of human suffering is an invitation for us to work to ease and alleviate human suffering in order that we might bring glory to our God before the universe. Amen. Christians cannot walk indifferently by when the man is on the road, like the priest and the Levite did. When there is human suffering, it is our Christian, not just our responsibility, but it is our privilege to work to alleviate that suffering in order, as it says in Matthew 5:16 and verse 17 there, it says, so let your light shine before men so other men may see your good works and give glory to our Father which is in heaven. So we have a responsibility as Christians to alleviate human suffering wherever it crosses our path. We must do the work of Him who sent us. And you may say, well, you know, I can't alleviate all of human suffering, but when there is a case in front of you and you know about it and you can do something about it, yes, do something about it. Hallelujah. When I broke my legs up in Canada in 2017, I came back, had my surgery, and a week later, an elderly couple came to visit me from a local village church there, and they brought with them 2 5-gallon buckets. And I wondered, okay, you know, what are they going to do to me here? And they said, we're going to fill up one with icy cold water and one with the hottest water you can stand. And my leg was swollen from the surgery. And say, you're going to put your leg into the hot water and then the cold water and then the hot water and the cold water. And I thought, what witch's brew is this? But I did as I was told because I was still weak from my surgery. And they did this hot and cold treatment on my leg. And they did it every day for a week. And by the end of that week, the swelling from my leg had all gone. My leg was all coming back to normal size again. And you know what? That elderly couple, nobody asked them to come around. But they, out of the goodness of their heart, saw a suffering brother in Christ. And they said, we're going to help him the way we can. And they did what they could. And because of what they did, I have nothing in my mind other than fond memories and deep affection for that elderly couple. When you minister to somebody in their moment of need, they're willing to accept what you have to say to them because they know that you genuinely care about them. There was a student missionary in Southeast Asia where Sister Paula was working. I think it was before your time, Sister Paula. And I got up one morning and I'd just turned 40 years old. Maybe some of you heard that sermon once. And I put my foot out of the bed and it felt like I was stepping on a nail. And it was agonizingly painful, so I hopped to the restroom and I sat down and I got out my phone and said, what causes like a nail coming through your ankle, the heel of your foot? And I discovered that I had plantar fasciitis. And so I read a bit more and it says plantar fasciitis normally hits men aged 40 and above. And it was my 40th birthday. I thought this is remarkably accurate. So I did a quick Google search for what other medical ailments hit men aged 40 and above. And it was such a long list, I thought, I better forget about this. But Anyway, I was hobbling around. I was in this country, Southeast Asia. One of our student missionaries looked at me. She was a physical therapist. And she says, "You've got plantar fasciitis." I said, "Yeah, I have." She says, "Just sit down there for a minute." And she took some medical tape and she ran it from the back of my heel, along the front of my foot, up to my big toe, then once around my foot like that. She says, "Now, walk around." And the pain was gone. She says, "You keep that on for a few weeks, your pain will go." And I've never had it since. And I can tell you this, when somebody ministers to your physical and medical needs out of the goodness of their heart, your heart is open to whatever they have to say to you after that. And so we as Christians, that the existence of human suffering is a call from God to labor to ease that human suffering in order that we might bring glory to our Heavenly Father in the universe. Maybe there's somebody in your life who you know is suffering. Maybe today you can visit somebody, visit them in the hospital, visit them in their home. Maybe they're recovering from surgery, they need their shopping done. Something practical. There's something all of us can do. But as we labor to ease the suffering of others, we open the door for spiritual conversations, and God is glorified in the lives of atheists and secular and materialistic people. Jesus goes on to say this, John 8:12, in this passage. Again, Jesus spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world." A very familiar passage that he says earlier in the Gospels. "Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And then that's in John 8:12, but in John 9:5, he says, "When in the world I am, light I am of the world." Now in John 8, verse 12, you see on the screen there, Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." That is a definite article. So he is most definitely, he is the light of the world. All other light is secondary to the light that comes from Jesus Christ. But in John 9, verse 5, he doesn't call himself the light of the world. He says, "When in the world I am, light I am of the world." That is, this is a more general description of who he is from John 8 to John 9. John 8, he is the light. And in John 9, it says, "When in the world I am, light I am of the world." What is Jesus getting at here? Jesus, in this passage in John 9, is not just referring to himself as being the light of the world, but now he's talking about the millennia to come when his disciples are going to be his ambassadors, and they are going to represent the light of the world in their generation, in their county, and in their lives. Jesus is expanding this concept of life of the world from himself to you and I today. And for Jesus and for us, there is a sense of urgency. There is a sense of urgency here. I must do the works. We must work the works of him who sent me. While it is day, night is coming when no one can work. For Jesus and for us, there is a sense of urgency. We only have one life. We actually only have today. Today is the last day of human history. There has not been a 25th day in the March of the year 2024 yet in human history. Today is quite literally the last day that has ever been lived in human history. It is the last day that you have ever lived today in your life. Tomorrow may or may not come for all we know. I was in Romania recently, they said, "We're not worried about the end of the world." I said, "Why not?" They said, "Well, we're 50 years behind the rest of the world. So if the world ends, we'll know about it in 50 years' time." But you can't have that attitude spiritually, all right? We must work the works of him who sent us while it is day. We only have one life. Jesus left this earth, he ascended to heaven, and each one of us has on average 70 years before we die, 70. Calvin put it this way, he said, "As the shortness of daylight stirs laborers to industry, that they may not be overtaken by the darkness of night in the middle of their work, so when we see that a short time of life is allotted to us, we should be ashamed of lazing in idleness." End quote. We have one life. We have today to work the works of him who sent me, to be faithfully transmitting and reflecting the light from Jesus as the light of the world into the dark places of planet Earth. And here in Tennessee, despite the sun outside, there's plenty of darkness in this state. There's despair. There are deaths of despair. There are suicide rates. There's meth addiction and opioid addictions and porn addictions and sports addictions and alcohol addictions. These are all signs of a society medicating its pain. The more the addiction, the more pain there is in our society. And our homes are being torn apart by addiction because people's hearts are breaking with fear and with pain. So if you say there is nothing for me to do, I'd say you're probably just as blind as the man in this story here. There is an ample field of labor for us today here in Tennessee. I forget where I am sometimes. There's an ample labor field for us here in southern Tennessee, and we must work the works of him who sent us. The alleviation of human suffering by the followers of Christ does more to win people to Jesus Christ than almost anything else. So ask God to bring somebody into your life who is suffering, that you may minister to them. Now, in Matthew 24, this is a verse that I often think about. Matthew 24, 25 is the fifth sermon in the book of Matthew. Matthew's got five sermons in it. We know the first one, the Sermon on the Mount, 5 through 7. We know the last one, 24 and 25. I'd give you a challenge. Go home today and find the other three sermons in the book of Matthew. But in this sermon here, where you have these end-time parables, Jesus says this. He says, "Who then is the faithful and wise slave whom his master has put in charge of his household to give the other slaves their allowance of food at the proper time? Blessed is that slave whom his master will find at work when he arrives." Now, if you are in a management position, this passage tells you that it is a moral responsibility to pay your workers on payday. The literal message from this. People depend on getting their wage when they're expecting to get their wage. They've got credit cards to pay off. They've got school bills. They've got medical debts. They've got to pay their rent. It is a spiritual responsibility and an act of worship to God if you're in a management position or you own your own business to never delay payroll. Because people's lives depend on it. And people have such, they have almost zero margin of error. And if anything goes wrong, like you're driving home as a single mum and you get a blowout on your tire, that can set off a cascading series of events that will tear that family apart, the mum and those young kids. And she spirals into debt and despair. Why? Because she had a blowout, because she's got no margin in her life. So we have responsibilities, literally, to make sure that those around us are being paid on time. We have responsibility also to make sure that we're feeding each other spiritually. We're providing spiritual food in due season for people in the right time. You know, speaking to somebody who's just lost a child in a road accident about their tithe reports is probably not the best of time to talk about that, all right? But knowing what to feed and when to feed from the Word of God, that's an important thing. We are to feed those around us, not just say hi and bye on Sabbath and hope they're going to make it through the next week. We're to feed one another, not just physically, but spiritually. We're to encourage one another. Night is coming, says Jesus, and there are some things that will not keep until after our earthly life is ended. Therefore, we must work while it is day. So this work is to so faithfully represent the light of the world in the gathering gloom through easing human suffering that we bring honor and glory, not to ourselves, not to our local church, but to our Heavenly Father. So I want to challenge you with this thought that Jesus is the shining light. He commissions us to be the light of the world, and as Jesus must work the work of him who sent him, that involves the easing of human suffering, so we are also commissioned by our Heavenly Father to labor to ease human suffering here in southern Tennessee. And if you're not sure how, where, and when you can do it, start praying for God to bring a broken person into your life, and he will. But the gloom is going to gather around us. Not just is there light in the world, but there is growing darkness in the world. Would you agree with me on that? There is darkness in our society. There is darkness in every society. And we're going to switch here not from the Gospel of John to the Epistle of John, the first epistle here, 1 John 1 and verse 5. And this is what we read there. It says, "This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light." So Jesus is the light of the world. We are the light of the world. And God is light also. "And in him there is no darkness at all." Now, in John's Gospel and in John's Epistles, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, John is very much into the idea of light and dark. And there's always a struggle between light and dark. Have you seen that in your lives? There is always a struggle between light and dark. Whenever there is light, the darkness is seeking to overwhelm it. When there is darkness, it's sometimes hard to bring light into that life because people are overwhelmed by the darkness. But there is a struggle between light and darkness, between good and evil in this world. And in this passage here, it says that God is light. Now, John does not say God is the light. as in Jesus is the light of the world. John uses a more generic term. There is no definite article. He says God is light. This is a quality of God, just as later in this epistle, 1 John 4:8, we read that God is love. He doesn't say God is the love. God is light and God is love. And so there is no surprise that as light is a quality of God's nature, what was the very first thing that God brought into existence in the creation story? Light. Let there be light. That was the very first thing that God brought into existence, and it's a reflection of his character. The goodness of creation is a reflection of the character of God. So we don't do it so much these days, but Adventists used to talk about nature as the second book of God's revelation. Going out and walking in nature, actually, and with eyes that are looking to see evidence of God's handiwork, is an incredibly growing experience for young minds and for children. Now, when we walk out in the woods, we all see different things. Like I have a twin brother, and he watches birds. To me, birds are things that fly. Beyond that, I'm not that interested in birds. But I understand. Birds are nice. You're a bird watcher, aren't you, Sister Paula? Yes. So as I go walking sometimes with my brother in the woods, he's looking for the birds, and he says, oh, that's a greater spotted wagtail from Florida. Oh, really? It flies. As long as it doesn't fly into me, I'm okay with it. Let it live its life. It's the greater spotted, it's the lesser spotted. Who cares at the end of the day? When I walk through the woods, I see holes for raccoons and groundhogs because I have an interest in those animals, particularly when they come and affect our gardens and go under our foundations. And the point is that we walk through the woods and we all see a very different thing. Well, light is a quality of God's nature, and so light was the first element of creation to come into being, Genesis 1:3. In Exodus chapter 19, when God descends upon Mount Sinai, his appearance, the personal appearance of God, is accompanied by indescribable, unapproachable light. God is described in Isaiah chapter 60 as an everlasting light. According to 1 Timothy 6:16, he dwells in light which no person can approach. And according to Habakkuk 1:13, light always dispels darkness, and the darkness of sin cannot dwell in the light of his presence. So God is light. Now literally the text says, darkness in him is not one darkness. And so there's a double negative in this in the Greek that just doesn't come across to us. But John is saying there is only, God is light, and there is nothing in God, no kind of darkness in God whatsoever. God is light, period. There is no mixture of lights and darkness in God. God is light and nothing else. And this is an important thing. Now, when this was written, 1 John in the 1st century AD, there was a religious group called Gnostics. You've heard of the Gnostics? And so gnosis means knowledge. If you're an agnostic or agnosis, it means you have no knowledge of whether God exists or not, yes? An atheist lives life without God. Atheos means without God. Agnostic lives life without knowledge, that they don't know whether God exists or not. And we are theists. We believe in a loving, personal, heavenly Father. Okay, that's the difference. And many Adventists, they call themselves theists. They're actually deists because they say, I believe in God, but they push him up into the hierarchy, up into the heavens there. And they say, well, he wound up the universe and he's walked away and he takes no personal interest in my life. And because if God takes no personal interest in my life, therefore I don't need to have a devotional life because he's not going to respond to me. So many Adventists are actually functionally deists. They're not theists. Because they don't believe God is interested in my life, therefore there's no point in having a devotional life. But if you believe God is interested in you as an individual, then you're going to read the Word of God every day because that's where you're going to hear him speak to you. So literally, darkness in him is not one darkness. Now, in the time this was written, there was a mystery religion called the Gnostics. And they held that good and evil were both in existence simultaneously. They were necessary counterparts of one another. And that both sprang from the same source, that is God himself. If, however, according to this text, God is light and in him there is no darkness at all, then Gnosticism is not true. Because Gnostics taught that God is both light and dark. But John says, no, God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. And you say, well, how does that relate to us today? All right, so you've heard of the yin and the yang? You know that little symbol? Part of Taoist and Confucian thought? Well, the yin represents femininity. It is dark, it is cold, it is passive. The yang represents masculinity and light and warmth. And in Confucian thought, yin and yang need almost to, always to be in balance. They don't oppose each other, but they're complementary to each other. And they are mutually perpetuating forces. That means you need the presence of good and evil, yin and yang, masculine and feminine, always pushing on each other to have meaning in life. And there are many young people today, and older people, who think about these Confucian thoughts. The yin and the yang are a familiar sight even in our Western society today. But according to this passage here, in God there is no opposite of light or darkness. You do not need darkness in order for good to be perpetuated in this universe. God is light. God is only light. In God there is no darkness at all. So this is a rejection of Confucian and Taoist thought right here. And you may say, well, how does that affect our young people? Well, you're familiar with Star Wars, yes? And may the what be with you? May the Force be with you. Now, in Star Wars, which is kind of a New Age concept, the Force can either, it's a neutral thing, and you can go on the dark side in which you become like Darth Vader, or you can become a Jedi Knight like, okay, and you become a Jedi Knight, okay. And so in Star Wars, we have this idea in our popular culture today that the Force, may the Force be with you, it can either be turned into a force for good or it can be turned into a force for evil. That the Force contains both good and evil, light and darkness. And Darth Vader, does he appear in a light suit in Star Wars? No, there is darkness and there is light. We have lightsabers, for instance, in Star Wars. So what Jesus is saying here directly rebukes much of modern popular culture in America today. It isn't some ancient document we're talking about here. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. And when you accept the idea that there is good and there is darkness, there is good and there is evil, and that you need both to have balance in life, it implies that I can do some good things in life, but in order to have balance, I must also have some bad things in my life in order for there to be a suitable yin and yang balance in my existence. So once we accept these modern philosophies, we are opening our doors to Satan in our lives. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. The claim to fellowship here, if we say that we have fellowship with him, with God, while we are walking in darkness, if this is what we claim, then he says we lie and we do not do what is true. The thing about this is this, that the claim to fellowship with God must be demonstrated in practical results in how you live your life. We cannot claim fellowship with God the Father and his Son while continuing to walk in the darkness. We are to walk through life conscious of God's conscious presence and always seeking to walk in the light. And young people pick up something called hypocrisy really quickly. If we as parents know the light and claim to walk in the light, but our children see that in home after Sabbath we actually live in the darkness, that will drive them away from God quicker than anything else. Young people have a radar for hypocrisy, religious hypocrisy. So this says, if we say that we have fellowship with him, this is not talking about Christians or people who have no knowledge of God. This passage is talking about those who know who God is and know who God the Son is. That is, they know what truth is. They know what light looks like. So these are people who are knowingly, intentionally, deliberately proclaiming, yes, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, while simultaneously actually living lives of spiritual darkness. This is not just religious hypocrisy. This is, you might say, the Laodicean condition. We lie, says John, and we do not do the truth. Now, he doesn't say we lie and we do not know the truth. He says we lie and we do not do, the text says we do not make what is the truth. Now it's an interesting concept here that we think of truth as like a concept, don't we? Like, this is true, okay? Tax day is coming up, yes? April 15, it is true, there is a tax day coming up. It is true that hopefully we'll have a potluck after this sermon. Hopefully, at least. Some things are true, but we think of truth as Westerners as like an intellectual idea. But in John's writings, truth and salvation are not so much intellectual ideas, but how you live your life. And so in this passage here, it says, we lie and we do not do or we do not make what is true. What John is saying here, it says, it's not so important what you know, because we say we have fellowship with him. We know what is the truth. We know what is truth. But he says, we lie and we do not do what is true. That is, truth is something that you make in your life. You do truth in your life. You don't just know the truth. You don't just have an intellectual assent to truth, an agreement, yes, these 28 fundamental beliefs are true. You make the truth in your life. Amen. Like you're building, let's say, a marriage, or you're building a business, or you're building a relationship, or you're building a Sabbath school class, or you're building a health ministry for your local community. We do what is true. We build that which is true. And that which is true is a representation of God's character in that particular aspect of our lives. So if we claim we have fellowship with Christ, while we are walking in the darkness, we are religious hypocrites, and our children pick up on it really quickly, we are lying. We're lying to God, we're lying to society, and we're not doing what we should do, which is to build lives of truth. So in John chapter 3:16, that whosoever what in him? Believes. And as Westerners, we often amend that. We say that whosoever has faith in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And the word to have faith, faith is a noun. Like, yes, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. So does Satan. Congratulations. You believe there is a final judgment? So does Satan. He knoweth that his time is short. You believe that God exists? So do the demons, and they shudder. James chapter 3. Just because you know something that is true doesn't mean it has any impact on your life. John 3:16 says that whoever believes in him, that's a verb, it's not a noun. If you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, then you build what is true in your life. You express your faith in how you live your lives. That means if your employer says there are multiple genders, you say, no, there's male and female, and that's the end of the story. And all these other lies that we're being forced to accept, men can become women, women can become men. I can identify as a parrot or as a kitty cat. Who knows these days? We're not going to go down that particular rabbit trail today. But I did have my legs operated on in 2017. This is a side story. And in the final check, the prep room where every nurse comes in, they say, what's your name and what's your date of birth? Just to make sure you're the right person, you know? And she looked at me, and I was sitting in my chair. My wife was sitting next to me, and she says, name, date of birth, yes. She says, and gender. I thought, oh. I said, what are the options? And she says, we have male, female, or other. I said, and under the other, do you have to type in what I am? She says, yeah, there's a space for me to type it in. I said, well, let me have a think about that. And I had a thought about it, and I said, I'm a parrot. And the nurse didn't know how to respond to this, because I said it with a dead straight face. I was clearly joking. A very serious face said, I'm a parrot. And she looked at me, and I was waiting for, like, start typing P-A-R-R-O-T into the computer system. And I said, I have a question. I said, did the surgeon, was he qualified to work on parrot's legs? And no answer came back at me. So eventually I said, no, actually I'm a male, just in case you weren't thinking about that. But the point is that we are being forced to accept lies in our society on a daily basis. Accept the lies or we will cancel you and destroy you in modern American society. And those who have claimed to have fellowship with Jesus Christ, we live, we make, we build the truth in our lives. That means when people take a look at us, they see the truth of God's character, the truth of God's will for fallen humanity, and they see the truth of God's created order in our lives. We lie and we do not do what is true, says the apostle here. For John, we do not merely know or have the truth, we do or we make the truth. Truth is not merely understanding correct teaching of Scripture. Satan knows the truth. But disciples, they do the truth, that they put the practice of Jesus into practice. They put the teachings of Jesus into practice on a daily basis. Whosoever believeth in me, that means your faith is expressed in your life. Paul talks about faith as a noun. John talks about believe, that is the corresponding verb, repeatedly through his writings. So John 3:19 through 20. And I'm not sure why this text is coming up here. Well, let's read it anyway. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who hate evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed.
Some men are so addicted to sin that they intentionally seek the darkness in order that they may sin more fully and more effectively. This is also religious hypocrisy if it's practiced in Christian families. How we live as Christians is not just what people see on Sabbath morning. It's what our children see on Thursday evening. It's what our children experience on Sabbath morning when you're rushing to get to church. Parents, listen to me carefully on that. How you treat your children coming to church has a big impact on whether they receive the gospel in the pews.
Yes, Lord.
So, this is the judgment from God, that light has come into the world in the person of Jesus Christ, but people love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. And I would say this to you today, we're at that stage of life in American society where people are not just hiding their darkness, they're celebrating and taking pride in it on a daily basis. And they're flaunting it before God. And when on the first day in office, our current president signed a law, an executive order on transgenderism, he was shaking his fist in the face of God. That's what he was doing, denying the created order, saying, this is what you say, but we know better. John 3:21, but those who do what is true come to the light. That is, you make truth in your life. And when you want to make truth in your life, you come to the light, because the light that is in Jesus shows us how to build lives that are built on truth, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. So truth is not merely correct teaching of Scripture. Disciples put into practice the teachings of Jesus Christ. I said this last night, and I'll say it again. A disciple is one who follows the teachings of Jesus. How often are you reading the teachings of Jesus? Every day it should be. Whatever else you read. I mean, you go back to the Puritan like scholars, even some of the Catholic scholars of the Middle Ages, when they put these Bible reading plans together, there was always something from the Psalms, from the Gospels, and the rest of Scripture. Christians of all stripes, hues and stripes, recognize that the daily diet of a Christian includes something from the Gospels, something from the Psalms, because it connects with your emotional life better than anything else, and something from somewhere else in the Scripture. I want to encourage you today that from this day forward, you will read something from the Scriptures, from the teachings of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, on a daily basis. And you're going to put it into practice. And people can say, why are you doing that? Because Jesus commanded this. This is how I live my life. Not according to what Fox or CNN say, not what Biden or Trump says, not what this theory or that ideology says. No, I build my life on the teachings of Jesus. The wise man builds his house upon the rock. And when the storms of life come, the house and the truth that you are building does not fall down when the storms of life come. And the rock that we are to build on at the end of Matthew chapter 7 there is the teachings of Jesus Christ. So are we putting into practice the teachings of Jesus? Do we know the teachings of Jesus? Are we feeding on the teachings of Jesus? If we're not, we're going to be like foolish men who build their house upon the sand. And when the storms of life come knocking on your door, as they will do, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13 says, and when that evil day comes, then it comes to every home, your house, what you've built, will be revealed to be nothing of gold or steel or cement or iron. It'll just be of wood and straw, and it's just going to collapse. When you see secular people grieving over a lost child, grieving without hope, you realize they haven't built on the truth. When that child dies, their lives are just torn apart. But if they would know the truth about God and the beauty of the resurrection, they could see beyond the grave and see that one day that child will be restored to them. What you build your life on matters. We are to build our lives personally as followers of Jesus Christ on the teachings of Jesus. So I want to encourage you, if you do nothing else from this last night and today, start reading and memorizing portions of the teachings of Jesus Christ and putting them into practice in your life. And if anybody says, why are you doing that? This is on the authority of God himself. This is thus saith the Lord. This is what I'm doing. No matter what mandates may say to me, no matter what governments may say to me, no matter what my spouse may ask of me, my word is based on the word of God. So, but men prefer to do their deeds in darkness because they prefer their sins. But those who do or make, they build their lives upon truth, they come to the light. You know, funny, I was just talking in Sabbath school this morning and about my mission experience in Papua New Guinea. What I discovered on my first night out there is that when there's no power in Papua New Guinea at night, the only power you have is your laptop. And you say, I'll try and knock off, you know, part of a sermon here.
And because it's the only light in the room, you get these hundreds of bugs flittering around your head and all over that screen. It's terrible. And in this big training center that I showed you the pictures of this morning, they brought in one of those like touch sensitive screens. You can draw things on it with your fingers. So you're standing up there and the screen is going all black and haywire behind you. Why? Because every time a bug, because it gets dark and there's a battery on this thing, it's the only light in the room. And so thousands of bugs are attracted to that touch sensitive screen, and suddenly commands and instructions appearing all over the screen, because every time the bug hits it, something else gets set off in it. It was a nightmare. But the point is the bugs come to the light. And are we coming to the light? Are you coming to the light? Are we feeding on the light? Or are we preferring to hide in darkness? What are you feeding your mind on YouTube or on the Word of God? Amen. What are you feeding your mind on, Twitter or the Word of God? Are your opinions formed? Yes, thank you, sister. Is your opinion formed because it's politically correct, or is it because it's the truth of the Word of God? And our nation is dying. It is dying. Because fewer and fewer people can say, and thus in my life, thus saith the Lord. I'm going to do what God says, not what the herd expects of me today. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. It's a beautiful promise. If we choose to walk in the light, as Jesus himself is the light, we have fellowship with one another. There's koinonia. Last night we spoke about having koinonia with Christ in his sufferings in 1 Peter 3, that God purifies us. We have fellowship with God when we have koinonia with him in suffering. Here it says, if I choose to walk in the light and you choose to walk in the light, inevitably our lives are going to be drawn closer together because we're all following the same teachings. And if I choose to walk in the light, but you choose to walk in the light of Twitter or Elon Musk or something else, there's going to be constant division in the church. We are to be drawn to the light as the moths of Papua New Guinea come to my laptop screen. And thus we are drawn not just closer to God, but we are drawn closer one to another. We realize we serve the same God. We believe the same truths. One baptism, one faith, one hope, one Lord and Savior, etc. One gospel message, one Holy Spirit, one set of gifts. We follow the same instructions in the pathway of life. And as we are come closer to each other, so all the divisions the world says that should hold us apart, those are melted away. Because we are one in Jesus Christ. Okay, this world tells that we should be divided along racial lines, along sexual orientation lines, along gender identity lines, along economic lines, along I'm from a Yankee from the north, I'm from the deep south. This society specializes in dividing us up and turning us on one another. And as Christians, we are to be a standing rebuke to the world that in Christ, people of every nation, tribe, language, and people can find an essential unity that cannot be found anywhere else in planet Earth. And we find that unity not when we sit around and, you know, hold each other's hands and stuff and, you know, have these, you know, kumbaya moments. No, we find unity when we come to Jesus Christ and we all say, what does Jesus say about this? We're going to put it into practice the best way we possibly can. And only thus do we find unity in Jesus Christ. Amen. And we can be a standing rebuke to the ideologies of the world that divide us today, recognizing that even those who have fellowship with God will continue to need cleansing from sin. John assures the Christian here that God has already anticipated our need for forgiveness and provided it through the blood of Christ and Jesus' high priestly ministry. If we walk in the light, if I walk in the light, I build my life in the light. I only walk where the light is. If there's light here and there's darkness there, I'm not going to turn aside in that path there. And if we all seek to walk in the light and come close to the light, we have the assurance that when we stumble, and we do stumble, that the blood of Christ will cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Amen. And then we can have, as this epistle later says in 1 John chapter 5, we can have the assurance of salvation. Yes. And too many Adventists die with no assurance of salvation. We can have the assurance of salvation. But this struggle between good and evil, between light and darkness, is going to affect the church until the time of Christ. So my wife says, I have a really good ability to depress people. So I want to depress you for a few minutes here, okay? You must understand this, says Paul to his young protege Timothy, that in the last days, distressing times will come. For people will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, inhuman, implacable, slanderers, profligates, brutes, haters of good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to the outward form of what? Godliness, but denying its power. He says, avoid them. So who is Paul speaking about here, the church or the world? The church. That in the last days, the church is going to be divided. We saw last night, there's going to be apostasy, there's going to be brother will betray brother, children will betray parents, false prophets will rise, there'll be schismatic movements, the rise of lawlessness in the church, the rejection of the law of God leads to the loss of love within the church. The church at the end of time will be loveless, divided, full of betrayal, full of false prophets, full of apostasy, full of schismatic movements. That's what we read last night, and here we have the description of the church in these last days, and today is the last day of human history, so far. This is the spiritual condition of the church. So even within the church, there's going to be darkness. We can't expect only light from the church. A candle, Jesus walks among the candles in Revelation 1, and if you ever lit a candle under a white ceiling, painted white, what happens to that ceiling after a certain amount of time? And it goes like, it gets smudged, doesn't it? Soot. So every candle gives out light, but it also gives out soot. And that's the condition of the human church. We give out light and we give out soot, sometimes in equal quantities. Sometimes we give out more smoke than light, but it's still giving out some light. And Jesus walks among the candles, even though they're giving out soot and smoke, because some light is better than no light. Goes on to say, the apostle Paul goes on to say, but wicked people and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving others and being deceived. Now here he's talking about the world in general. So we see that in the struggle between light and darkness, while we build our lives on the truth, we make truth in our lives, and if we live in the light and we have fellowship with one another, we have the assurance of salvation, we see that around us the church is getting morally and morally more and more bankrupt and decadent, and society is getting worse, and it's going from bad to worse to evil. And if you hadn't noticed it, the gloves in the great controversy have now come off. Put your kids in public school and you'll soon discover that the gloves have come off. Your children will come home wondering, what am I today? Who am I today? This is being promoted in our public schools. And children these days don't want to be heterosexual anymore, because that's the uncool thing to be. I need to identify as something else. We have public schools in America putting cat litters into the girls' restrooms, because the girls identify as cats. There was one guy who was taking the Mickey. Is that an American expression? He was making fun of this. He stood before a school board in Oregon, and he says, my daughter identifies as a terrapin. And therefore, I'm requesting that the school board put a terrarium in every schoolroom, heated to 90 degrees Fahrenheit, so my daughter can go from terrarium to terrarium, so that she's always at the ideal body temperature for a terrapin. And the school board looked at him with all seriousness. Then the school board chair says, brother, he says, we're going to have to refer that question to the maintenance department. But they didn't look at him and saying, you're crazy. Your daughter thinks she's a terrapin? Well, in that case, we have provided terrapins environment for her. You know, it's absurd, isn't it? You kind of wonder, if this child really is a terrapin and I run her over with my car, would I be done for murder? Because you can't murder a terrapin, by definition. You can't. Would I be charged with murder for killing a girl who identifies as a cat? If she's truly a cat, you can't be charged with murder. So the legal system prosecutes you for not affirming this gender identity nonsense, but if you act on that gender identity nonsense, you'll be prosecuted as well. The system is lies upon lies upon lies. It goes on here about what's happening in the church. For the time is coming when people have to put up with sound doctrine, will not put up with sound doctrine, but have itching ears. They will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own desires and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander away to myths. So once again, we find at the end of time, not only is the church filled with unsanctified people, but the church finds for themselves preachers who teach them what they want to hear, which is taking them away from the truth of Scripture and is leading them down human ideology and human myths. And that is happening in the church as well today. I'm not going to go into any great details up here because time is moving on here, but that is happening. And then we find at the end of time, as this gathering gloom is coming upon our world, Peter says this: first of all, you must understand this, that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and indulging their own lusts. Now we have the sanctification of lust in our nation. We call it sexual orientation. And saying, where is the promise of his coming? For ever since our ancestors died, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. They deliberately ignore this fact that by the word of God, heavens existed long ago and an earth was formed out of water and by means of water, through which the world of that time was deluged with water and perished. So in these last four passages I've just shown you, we see that at the end of time, the world will be actively hostile to the followers of Jesus Christ. The world does not want the light that comes from the followers of Jesus Christ. The world will scoff and mock the followers of Jesus Christ, and they're going to be scoffers of the Adventist message. And when you think about it, from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 20 through 24, when Jesus comes again, the demons are going to be destroyed. It's not just when Jesus comes again, the dead in Christ are raised. When Jesus comes again, the forces of evil are destroyed. The demons do not want to hear the second coming of Jesus Christ. When you announce the coming of Jesus Christ and you work for the second coming of Jesus Christ, you are hastening the destruction of those demons, which is why gospel work, pastoral work, missionary work is always run in the face of demonic opposition. Because as you advance the kingdom of God and the gospel goes to every nation, tribe, language, and people, you are bringing forward in time that day when Jesus comes again. And that brings forward the destruction of the demons. So when we talk about spiritual warfare, it's not just them attacking us. When we proclaim, as we will this afternoon, some aspects about the second coming of Jesus, please stay for that. We are actually challenging the demons, saying your destruction is sure and we're working to hasten it. Amen. And that's good news. But it brings us into a battle. So there is Jesus is the shining light in the world and we are commanded to be the light of the world. But then we see that there is a gathering gloom in our world and each of us has to choose day by day whether we will walk in the light that we have or whether we will know the light but prefer to walk in the darkness. And if we're going to walk in the light, it means we build truth in our life. Our homes, our marriages, our businesses, our enterprises, we are building truth into, we're weaving it into every aspect of our lives. Does it make sense to everybody? So then we come to the darkest gloom. And we're not talking about the Tennessee Titans here. I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head and you will strike his heel. From the very beginning of human history, there have been two opposing groups, the woman and the serpent. The seed of the woman versus the seed of the serpent. You may ask, who is the serpent? Well, most of us know, but for those who don't know, we explain scripture from scripture. The great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who was called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth and his angels were thrown down with him. So we have the struggle between the serpent, which is Satan, and between the woman and the seed of the woman. And the Apostle Paul identifies who the seed of the woman is. And because in Hebrews, Genesis chapter 3, the word seed is singular, Paul applies it to Jesus Christ in particular. Here in Galatians 3, he says, now the promises made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say and to offsprings, that is plural, as of many, but it says and to your offspring, that is to one person who is Jesus Christ. So Jesus is the seed of the woman. The seed of the woman. Satan is the serpent in this thing here. But the seed of the woman are also the church of Christ. A great portent appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, on her head, a crown of 12 stars. And throughout salvation history, the seed of the woman, plural, that is those who are faithful to God, have always been battling against Satan, the prince of darkness. It's always been there. We start out in Hebrews 11, verse 4, with Abel and Cain. Abel walked in the footsteps of his heavenly father. It says, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain's. Through this he received approval as righteous, God himself giving approval to his gifts. He died, but through his faith he still speaks. Abel walked in the footsteps of his heavenly father in the way of the cross, and he became identified with the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. And the faithful line of from Abel. Abel died. It was replaced by Seth in Genesis 5. This righteous line saw incredible longevity, such as Methuselah, Enoch. Enoch did not die, but was taken up to heaven. He was not, for God took him, says Genesis 5:24. He had a boy called Methuselah, the person who lived longer than anybody else in human history, over 900 years. His name is a prophecy. It means when he dies, it shall come. What was going to come? The flood. Just after Methuselah died, then comes the flood. So while Methuselah is alive, everybody knows there is hope. Probation hasn't closed. But when Methuselah dies, everybody knows. When he dies, the end shall come. It shall come. So when Methuselah died, his life and his death were a living illustration of the truth of Noah's preaching. Then along comes Noah, who alone was righteous in his generation. John 8:44, Jesus speaks to the Jews who are attacking. He says, "You are from your father, the devil, and you choose to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks according to his nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies." So Cain walked in the footsteps of Satan, his true father, who was a murderer and a liar from the beginning. His descendants went out from the presence of God, and rather than subduing the earth, they chose to make cities. They gloried in the works of their own hands. They forgot God in the process, till you come to Lamech, who introduced both murder and polygamy to the human experience. And despite God's warnings not to be unequally yoked with unbelievers, Seth's descendants intermarried with the descendants of Cain. So by the time you get to Noah in Genesis 6, there is only one righteous person left on planet Earth. And who is that? Noah. Shem, Ham, and Japheth are not counted among the righteous, nor is Noah's wife, nor are Shem, Ham, and Japheth's three wives. It says Noah alone was righteous in his generation. And because the plan of salvation now hinged upon the survival of one man, Noah, God decides to bring an end to the human experience, and we have the flood. And you may say, well, why would God allow the flood? Why would God kill so many people? God is light. In him there is no darkness. Why is genocide not considered darkness? It says, "The Lord saw that the wickedness of humanity was great upon the earth, that every inclination of the thoughts of their hearts was only evil continually." So I want you to imagine something. You have a daughter who's 16. She gets caught by human traffickers. What do you wish for as a father? You wish for one of two things. Lord, bring her home today, or let her die today. But do not allow her to live for the next 10 years in a living hell. That is, a loving father wishes for the death of a child who is caught up in an inescapable situation of indescribable pain. It is not the actions of a monster in heaven that brings the flood about. It is a heavenly father that says, "These are all my children. Their suffering has no way out. It is a merciful thing to bring it to an end." So God is a God of mercy. He allows this and brings this flood on this earth because that's the only way that indescribable human suffering can come to a close. And after the flood, we come to this guy here, Nimrod. Cush became the father of Nimrod. He was the first on earth to become a mighty warrior. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord, some versions say against the Lord. Therefore it is said, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord, the beginning of his kingdom was Babel, or Babylon, Erech, and Akkad, all of them in the land of Shinar. That's modern Iraq. And there's a lot we could say about Nimrod, but we won't say too much other than a few things here. Firstly, the Septuagint, that's the Greek translation of the Old Testament, which was used by the apostles, says that he was a mighty hunter against the Lord. So the Jews in the time of Jesus understood Nimrod not to be a mighty hunter before God, he was a mighty hunter against God. He wasn't viewed positively. And why is Nimrod viewed negatively? Because he had a kingdom. Yes? If you are a king, you are a monarch. Is that right? What does the word monarch mean? One ruler. Mono means only, or singular. Arche means head. A monoarche is a sole ruler. What this is saying is that God made Adam to be his vice regent on earth. We were given stewardship of the earth, but we are accountable to God for how we use the earth's resources. But when you have a monarch and a monarchy, you are saying that man, the top ruler, is not accountable to God at all. It's just God. It's just the king, just the ruler, just the monarch. And God is written out of the picture. You following this? So this is why the arrival of monarchy is the arrival of secular humanism, which is there is no God out there. We figure out our own problems for ourselves. We're accountable to nobody. We do as we wish. And with Nimrod, we have the arrival of modern-day paganism. His kingdom was Babel. The word Bab-Ilu means the gates of God. It means that the gods are somehow distant, but now men are supreme and sovereign in the affairs of men down on earth. So with Nimrod, we have the arrival of humanism, and we have the arrival of deism, and we have the arrival of paganism. Now, paganism was designed to war against faith in the Messiah. Now, hear this carefully, brothers and sisters. If we accept the lie of Satan, that you shall surely not die, then the wages of sin are not death, because you're not going to die. And if the sin does not lead to death, then you have no need of a Messiah. So the original lie teaches you that you have no need of a Savior. Ancient paganism was modern-day spiritualism in its infancy. And the ancient paganism and modern-day spiritualism are all built on the same lie, the immortality of the soul. This is the foundation lie that undergirds Islam, Catholicism, paganism, Hinduism, Buddhism, and animism. All of these major faiths in Earth's history, in our world today, have embraced the basic lie that is the immortality of the soul. As such, all of these are satanic faiths that war with our need of and our faith in the Messiah of God, who was sent to deal with the sin problem. Secularism is another kind of lie. It is based on the lie that there is nothing beyond this life. And if there is nothing beyond this life, then you don't need a Savior who will give you eternal life. So both secularism and all these other religions are ultimately coming from Satan. Now, when Nimrod died, his spirit was said to become immortal and it flew up to the sun to become the Lord of Heaven. His surviving wife claimed that her womb was miraculously impregnated by a sunbeam, and the resulting child, called Tammuz, became the sun god. This was the first counterfeit trinity. Nimrod, the sun god, Semiramis, the moon goddess, the queen of heaven, and Tammuz, the bright and morning star, or the counterfeit messiah. And that counterfeit trinity has flown through all many parts of the world. I'll just give you some examples there. Israel, Phoenicia, Babylon, Assyria, Greece, Rome, Egypt, India, China, Mexico, Scandinavia. That counterfeit trinity has flown all around the world, and it comes from originally from Nimrod, and the God, Satan inserting paganism into the human experience as a counterfeit to the gospel. Modern-day astrology is a form of paganism that embraces all forms of the occult. Its author is Satan, who was once Lucifer, the shining or illuminated one. The spirit guides of astrologers today are nothing more than demons. The chief star gods of the pagans are the gods of astrology, which in pagan thought are believed to be just emanations of the one true God, that is the sun god, the ruler of the zodiac, and he is believed to control your life. And today, these lies of Satan, this darkness from Satan, this is all pervasive. It impacts every aspect of our culture. It's in our entertainment. It's in our books. It's in our music. It's in the massive growth of the occult, of Wicca, of pagan practice, and in transgender ideology. Satan is no longer hiding. His crowning act, when the darkness is at its deepest, the final overwhelming delusion, will be to impersonate the second coming of Christ himself. We're going to spend a few minutes looking at that. 2 Corinthians 11:14 says, "No wonder even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light." Sister White talks about it this way. She says, "Satan will work wonders before men to make the world believe him to be Christ come the second time to our world. He transforms himself into an angel of light, but while he bears the appearance in every particular as far as appearance goes, he is not Christ." Now, Jesus warned us. Matthew 24 says, "False messiahs and false prophets will appear and produce great what? Signs and omens." That word omens is the word wonders. So signs and wonders, keep that in mind. "He will produce great signs and wonders to lead astray, if possible, the very elect." Who is Satan trying to deceive at the end of time through signs and wonders? The elect of God. Keep that in mind. 2 Thessalonians 2 talks about the parousia of Christ and the parousia of Satan. The word parousia means the advent or the appearance. And it says there, then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will destroy with the breath of his mouth, annihilating him by the manifestation of his coming. That word of his coming is the coming of Christ. It is the parousia of Jesus. Then it says, the parousia of the lawless one is apparent in the working of Satan, who uses all power, signs, and lying wonders. Remember that, power, signs, and lying wonders. That's how he deceives the world. Every kind of wicked deception for those who are perishing because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved, etc. And Peter describes the ministry of Jesus at Pentecost there as, you that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of what? Power, wonders, and signs. It's the same three words that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know. Let's put all those together. Matthew 24 and verse 24. Jesus warns of false prophets and false Christs. They will do signs and omens, or better translation, it's the same word. It's signs and wonders. The appearance of Satan is power, signs, and lying wonders. The ministry of Jesus is described in the same three words, power, wonders, and signs. The difference is that Satan's pre-advent coming, when he seeks to deceive the elect of God, it has powers and signs and wonders that look like and smell like and sound like and feel like the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ, but it's a lie. You following this? That is why we do not base our faith on miracles. Because miracles lead astray. Satan can give life. Satan can cause you to have incredible illnesses. Satan can miraculously heal you of your illnesses. We do not rely on miracles for our faith. Because Satan deceives through miracles. He can't counterfeit the word of God, but he can counterfeit miracles. So we read about in more detail the coming of Satan. Great controversy. I don't like putting text up like that, but I have today. As the crowning act in the great drama of deception, Satan himself will impersonate Christ. The church has long professed to look for the Savior's advent as the consummation of her hopes. Actually, Muslims are looking for the return of Jesus. Many Buddhists are looking for the return of an elevated teacher. Many Jews are looking for the return of the Messiah. Catholics are looking for the return of Jesus, and so are Protestants. Over half of planet Earth is looking for the arrival of a heavenly figure. That's why we're all prone, we're primed for deception. Now the great deceiver will make it appear that Christ has come. In different parts of the earth, Satan will manifest himself among men as a majestic being of dazzling brightness, resembling the description of the Son of God given by John in the Revelation. The glory that surrounds him is unsurpassed by anything that mortal eyes have yet beheld. The shout of triumph rings upon the air, Christ has come, Christ has come. The people prostrate themselves in adoration before him while he lifts up his hands and pronounces a blessing upon them, as Christ blessed his disciples when he was upon the earth. His voice is soft and subdued, yet full of melody. In gentle, compassionate tones, he presents some of the same gracious heavenly truths which the Savior uttered. He heals the diseases of the people, and then in his assumed character of Christ, he claims to have changed the Sabbath to Sunday and commands all to hallow the day which he has blessed. He declares that those who persist in keeping holy the seventh day are blaspheming his name by refusing to listen to his angels sent to them with light and truth. This is the strong, almost overmastering delusion. But the people of God will not be misled, later in the same chapter. The teachings of this false Christ are not in accordance with Scripture, not according to signs and wonders, but according to the Scriptures. His blessing, that is Christ's, Satan's blessing, is pronounced upon the worshippers of the beast in his image, the very class upon whom the Bible declares that God's unmingled wrath shall be poured out. And furthermore, Satan is not permitted to counterfeit the manner of Christ's advent. The Savior has warned his people against deception upon this point, and has clearly foretold the manner of his second coming. We'll talk about that this afternoon. There shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, is he in the secret chambers, believe it not. For as a lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Nobody can counterfeit lightning. I've discovered that wherever you go on planet Earth, if you see lightning, everybody knows what lightning is. You can't counterfeit lightning. This coming, there is no possibility of counterfeiting. It will be universally known, witnessed by the whole world. Only those who have been diligent students of the scriptures and have received the love of the truth will be shielded from the powerful delusion that takes the world captive. Amen. This is the final deception, the darkest moment in Earth's history, when Satan appears as a brilliant angel of light and counterfeits the coming of Christ. And what of us today? As the gathering gloom affects our families, hurts our marriages, impacts our congregations, as the deepening darkness sheds ever-lengthening shadows across our society, as our own battle with the darkness of sin intensifies in Earth's last day, will we walk in the ever-increasing light of the second coming? Most Christians look back to Calvary, but with every passing day, Calvary gets further in the past and the shadows get longer. But as Adventists, we walk in the ever-brightening light of the second coming, which is coming every day. And the truth and the light and the glory of the second coming should be giving us more and more light on a day-to-day basis. We are not called to walk in the ever-lengthening shadows. We are called to walk in the ever-brightening light of the second coming of Jesus Christ. Will we profess today to walk in the light while privately preferring the darkness and the works of darkness? Or will we actually choose to walk in the light and make and build and do the truth of the teachings of Jesus in our personal and our professional lives and have fellowship with one another and with Jesus as the light of the world? That is our choice today. So in conclusion, a couple of things here. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous their ways, their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have what upon them? Mercy. And to our God, for he will what? So if the Holy Spirit has spoken to you today and said, there's darkness in your life, brother or sister, this is a promise from God for you. While you are alive, while it is day, work the works of him who sent us and turn away from sin. And if the Spirit has convicted you of a particular sin in your life, don't harden your heart, but turn away from that sin today. When you go home, you kneel beside your bed and you confess that sin before God, and you receive by faith the forgiveness of God, and you ask him for the grace and the strength to overcome that sin and that evil inclination in your life forevermore. Amen. He doesn't say he'll think about having mercy on you, he says he will have mercy upon you. Yes. Amen. Isaiah 1:16. Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, remove the evil of your doings from before my eyes, and cease to do evil. So not only are we to give ourselves in Isaiah 55 to fasting and prayer and seeking the Lord while he may be found, we also to positively choose to turn away and to renounce all known darkness in our lives. Amen. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. Amen. To all who believed, he became the power to become the sons and daughters of God. If I am a son of God, then there can be no darkness in my life. That is my spiritual ancestry. It is my spiritual birthright. It is what God is looking for me in my life as his child. It is what he's looking for you in your life. We turn away from darkness, and we ask our lives to be filled with only the light of the goodness and the character and the mercy of God. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day, coming back full circle to where we started our journey today. Night is coming when no one can work. I want to invite you today to recommit to God that we will do our utmost to alleviate human suffering whenever and wherever we find it. Amen. Let people know that the Jasper Seventh-day Adventist Church is a place of hope for the hurting in this community, where people of all backgrounds can come and find healing and hope and health for the future. So let us commit to doing this. That means giving of our time. It's easy to give money. It's easy to give a check to ADRA. What it's hard to do is to give your time. But that's what matters. People want a human connection, someone who will sit down and listen to them. Let people know that the followers of Jesus Christ alleviate human suffering wherever and whenever they come across it. And the last text for today, I know Arnold is gesticulating at me the back there, says, we've got potluck to get to. All right, thank you, Brother Arnold. Thank you for reminding me. Our last text for today This is Paul. He's just been rejected by the Jews of that particular city in Acts 13. He says, "For so the Lord has commanded us, saying, I have set you to be a light for the Gentiles, so that you may bring salvation to the end of the earth." That verse was first spoken in Isaiah over God's people Israel. It was then applied by Simeon over the babe Christ when Simeon was brought to him in the temple. The third time it is applied, this verse from Isaiah, it's to the church of God, that we are called by God to be a light for the Gentiles, so that we may bring salvation to the ends of the earth. I want to challenge you today to commit to bring salvation to the ends of the earth. Think about what you're going to do as a church. Maybe you'll support a missionary. Maybe you're going to go as a missionary. Maybe you want to support Adventist World Radio or Hope TV. But do something in the great controversy to bring light to the ends of the world. Everybody can do something. In AFM we say, pray, give, go. Everybody can do one of those three things. We've covered a long journey today, haven't we? We've come a long way. I'm not preaching these things for the good of my health. I'm preaching these things because everybody here is precious to God. And God is not willing that anybody here today should perish, but that everybody here today should have the gift of eternal life. I'm preaching these things today so that our families, our spouses, our children, our great-grandchildren may see our lives and see that there is a God in Israel and He saves His children. I've come down from Michigan here to preach these sermons because Brother Arnold asked me to. But I come and preach because God is good. And if you taste and you see, you'll realize that God is truly good. Amen. So as we go through this day, walk in the light. Seek the light. Build the light in your lives. May people see in your life the light of God, the light of Jesus Christ shining from you and drawing them all to the gift of eternal life. We're going to close now with a final hymn. Our final hymn will be 618, stand up for Jesus. We'll sing the first and the last verses, hymn number 618.
After we sing, we're going to have the invocation, and then I want to invite all of you to come to potluck. But as you go out the door, if you can please give some money as a love gift to help Pastor Vine continue on his ministry. Thank you.
Sorry, this is really mundane, but if it's a check, make it out to AFM, not to me personally. Okay.
Feels good to stand up, doesn't it? Stand up for Jesus. Stand up for Jesus.
Stand up for Jesus. Ye soldiers of the cross, lift high His royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, His army shall He lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey, for to the mighty conflict in this His glorious day. Strength alone, the arm of flesh will fail thee. He dare not trust our own. Put on the gospel armor and watching unto prayer. When duty calls our danger, be never afraid. stand up for Jesus. The strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him who overcometh, the crown of life shall be. He with the King
bow our heads and we'll close our eyes. Father, I pray that in each of our lives we will stand up and we will build and we will make and we will do the truth that is found in Jesus and his teachings. Father, may we build our lives upon that solid rock, that when the storms of life come, not only will the house that we've built survive, but others may find shelter under that selfsame roof. So, Father, in this coming week, bring to our minds the teachings of Jesus that we most need to hear. Lead us with your Spirit in how we are to put them into practice. May we, in truth, walk in the light. May we love the light. May the light shine through us. And may people take note that we are the men and women of Jesus Christ. So, Father, as we share this fellowship meal, we thank you for those who prepared the food. Bless our fellowship. Be the guest at every table. And with the strength it brings us, may we bring honor and glory to you. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Lord, lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace this day and forevermore. Amen.